pull in all of these resources to just to work on this scene. And here where I am, just about a block away, there are people milling around behind the crime scene tape. A lot of people hugging, even among some of the reporters here. It's just a terrible feeling, and made even more terrible by the fact that this is supposed to be a month of celebration in the gay community in Orlando. All across the country, this is Pride Month, and Orlando has a couple of celebrations scheduled throughout the month, and it's turned from celebration into tragedy here.
Now, Jeff, stay on the line with us, and we're going to come back to you. We have NPR Justice correspondent Carrie Johnson on the line, who's been following the investigation into what happened in Orlando overnight very closely. And Carrie, what do we know at this point?
Well, I'm hearing from two sources briefed on the investigation, David, that this suspect apparently called 911 before the shooting at the nightclub and pledged allegiance to the Islamic State. Now, that doesn't in and of itself indicate that he was directed by anybody overseas, any terrorist group overseas. Instead, he might have been inspired in part by social media or any number of other influences. That said, David, it's an important clue that investigators are going to be pulling on in the days ahead.
So we were talking to our colleague Dina Temperez in the morning about what it means to sort of decide whether this was an act of terrorism. She said even if there's not a link to some international group, if there was a political end or political motive, that would be some sort of terrorism. It sounds at this point, as you said, we don't know if pledging allegiance to the Islamic State means any sort of tie, but if he was saying that, I mean, that might tell us something about his motive and why he was wanting to do this.
That's exactly right. And of course, in San Bernardino last year, we had a very similar incident in which one of the shooters, one of the husband-wife shooters, went on social media and pledged allegiance to the Islamic State around the time of that attack as well. Authorities there have not been able to determine or uncover any links to overseas groups that may have directed those shooters. So instead, it could be an example of this homegrown domestic radicalization. And David, it's not at all clear that there wasn't a hate crime motive here too. Investigators, of course, are still following up in this case in Orlando on statements the suspect's father told NBC News about his animus against gay people.
Well, and we should say, I mean, if we sort of just, I mean, pick up any pieces we can here and put this together, that ISIS is a group that is known for being anti-gay, which is something Dina Temple-Raston pointed out. And they have, the people who are in favor of the group have been celebrating this attack this morning. Doesn't necessarily tell us anything about this person, Omar Mateen, but worth noting.
Yeah, there's no public claim of responsibility on social media by the Islamic State itself, but there have been a lot of hateful tweets and hateful rhetoric from them.
We're going to ask Jill Roberts from WQCS in Fort Pierce, Florida, to join us now. She is outside the apartment complex where the shooter lived. Police have evacuated the area. Jill, I gather you're seeing a large police presence at Omar Mateen's apartment, and a number of people have gone inside. Have you heard anything about what they might have seen or found?
We don't know if they found anything inside, but they have been here since very early this morning. And the bomb disposal group is here. The sheriff's department has confirmed for me that this is his apartment. They do know this is where he lives.
So they're concerned about booby traps, presumably.
Yes, they were going inside to look for explosives. That's why they had the bomb disposal unit here. And they did confirm that for us. That's when they entered the apartment, that's what they were going to look for.
Any neighbors there that are available to speak to?
Not right now, but the neighbors have been, because the apartment complex was evacuated, the neighbors have been around the periphery, around the crime scene tape, and none of them have said that they knew him directly, but they were all very shocked to find this in their midst.
What about family? Did Omar Mateen have any family members in Fort Pierce, Fort St. Lucie area?
Yes, there is another police presence, a law enforcement presence outside of his parents' home in Port St. Lucie. I haven't been down there, but I do know that they are down there as well.
And so you assume that they are thinking that these people may need some protection.
Well, and I'm sure there are questions that they want to ask them as well. And definitely, I know in previous situations where the FBI has gone in, that definitely, yes, they were looking to offer protection as well.
I'm just trying to piece together some Florida geography here. So Orlando is in central Florida, and I believe Fort Pierce, where you are, Jill, it's an hour or two down the coast, like near Vero Beach, but sort of still well north of Miami, Fort Lauderdale, West Palm Beach, sort of in a central part of the east coast of Florida. Is that right?
Yes, we are on the east coast, what we call South Central Florida here, and we are about an hour and a half north of West Palm Beach and maybe an hour and a half south of Cocoa.
We just heard from our justice correspondent, Kerry Johnson, that Omar Mateen, this man whose house you're watching the authorities search right now, called 911 and pledged allegiance to the Islamic State before he carried out this shooting. This news is just coming out now. I don't suppose we've had a chance to talk to people there, but that might be something that would be shocking for a community to hear.
Again, the people that I did talk to, they didn't know this person particularly, but they were shocked to find that something like this had obviously been planned for some time in their midst. And you know, also the realization that he could have done that here. And so that is scary to them as well.
What is the scene just like there? Are there many people sort of gathered around getting as close as they can to this? Or is the community just sort of followed these orders to evacuate and just get out?
Well, it's a very warm day, so people have come and gone. The people who don't want to necessarily stand around outside in the heat all day, but law enforcement definitely is there, both the Fort Pierce Police Department and the St. Lucie County Sheriff's Office, and they have their command vehicles there, and the bomb disposal team is there. And, usually when you're outside of a house or a place that the FBI is searching, you see them come out with bags and trash bags, and you can't see what's in them, but you know they're bringing things out. We haven't seen them bring anything out yet in this case, but they're definitely there. It's very active. There's a lot of law enforcement walking around, and the public has respectfully stayed on the periphery of the crime scene tape.
All right, that's Jill Roberts from our member station WQCS in Fort Pierce, Florida. And I guess we're following the story in a number of different places here. Right there in Fort Pierce, Florida, and there's the South Central Coast. The authorities are searching the home of Omar Mateen, a 29-year-old U.S. citizen who we just learned a few moments ago before he carried out this terrible shooting in Orlando early this morning. He called 911 to pledge allegiance to the Islamic State. We have the scene in Orlando where people are in shock, and there are upwards of 53 people at hospitals, in addition to the 50 dead in this nightclub. And we're waiting for the President of the United States here in Washington, D.C. to speak at the White House.
And we think, he's a little late, but we are assuming that he'll be coming soon. So we will stand by on that, and we'll bring him to you as soon as he steps out of his office and goes to the press room for a briefing. I was very interested to hear Kerry Johnson say that this reminds people of the events in California, in San Bernardino, because there was a warning, a call to 911, not to 911, but to, who did she say they called?
Yeah, they made a phone call to pledge allegiance
to ISIS.
Believe it was a post on social media, but either
right.
way, the...
But it's the same kind of format, the same idea. Call somebody, get the word out, talk about your allegiance, and then go do this thing. But in the case of the San Bernardino shooters, the husband and wife, they have not found anything. I mean, these people just seem to have, like, burst on the scene from nowhere.
Well, there was that long back and forth with the federal government and Apple over information in one of the shooters' iPhones and how to unlock that information, where the FBI wanted Apple to basically help them crack the code on the phone, help them write new code so that they could access the phone and the information there. That ultimately was resolved in that the FBI found a third party who was able to come and get that information from that phone. But that was, you know, I've been saying before that these events happen and you see them play out on the federal level in terms of policy debates and in terms of new directions for the government. That was one way that the San Bernardino shooting affected policy for months afterwards. This debate over whether or not the federal government has the power to get a private company like Apple to help collaborate in that sort of investigation.
We have another voice here we want to bring in as we await the President of the United States. Hannah Willard is Policy and Outreach Coordinator for Equality Florida. This is an organization dedicated to securing equality and justice for Florida's LGBT community, and is on the line now. Hannah, good morning to you. I know it's been a tough morning as we've been working through what took place in Orlando last night.
Yes, thank you for having me.
What are you hearing from members of your organization? I know one of the big questions here is whether the LGBT community was targeted early this morning at this club?
Well, right now we are all still reeling from the reality that 50 plus of our friends and loved ones were lost last night, and 50 plus more are fighting for their lives in the hospital. So this is a moment of absolute crisis and unspeakable violence. And we don't know the motive of the shooter. We don't know the details surrounding. There's still going to be more information, of course. But what we do know is that this is a person who, at the beginning of LGBT Pride Month, June being a month when we all celebrate the Stonewall Riot of the 1960s, he took open fire on a gay nightclub at maximum capacity. And so in the midst of our grief, we are more deeply resolved than ever to uproot homophobia and animosity towards gay and transgender people wherever it exists.
How did you hear about this, about the shooting, Hannah?
Well, I live in Orlando. I grew up here, actually, and I woke up this morning to a phone call from my boss. She was calling all of our Orlando staff to make sure that we were safe and that we were okay.
And Hannah, I guess it you know, we're still trying to figure out whether the gay community was targeted here, but you sort of were referring to this. I mean, what a moment. We've seen sort of a lot of change in this country, a Supreme Court decision supporting same-sex marriage. I mean, was this community that was feeling safer from hate and sort of not expecting and bracing for something like this?
Well, certainly we've come so far. I mean, June is a month where we also celebrate. Pride Month is a moment of marking the progress that we have made. And we're all thrilled to be marking the one-year anniversary at the end of June of that Supreme Court decision. But my goodness, there is no question that homophobia and bigotry are still alive and well in our state and in our country. We're at a moment of tumultuous debate over so many aspects of what it means to have full equality for gay and transgender people. You know, every single day I talk to people who have no idea that it's still perfectly legal here in Florida to fire someone for being gay, deny them housing for being transgender. So as we come together this month, now amidst all of this tragedy, we're more deeply resolved than ever to move forward to making sure that every single child growing up today knows that they are celebrated and valued for exactly who they are, no matter who they love.
It sounds like, I mean, even in the hours after the tragedy, as you said, you are still mourning the victims and know that there are many people in hospitals, some fighting for their lives right now, but you are already thinking about, I mean, this event being a moment that you are ready to start talking about and start talking about policies and start talking about, you know, things that are very important to the gay community.
Well, that's my reaction, I think, because I'd like to prevent something like this from ever happening again, of course. And, you know, we know that we've got to uproot the homophobia and the bigotry that still exists in our state. We will never know exactly what the shooter was thinking at that moment. We know, though, that this is LGBT Pride Month, and this is our community that was under attack. This was gay and transgender people at a nightclub celebrating a fun night out. And, you know, gay and transgender people want the same things that everybody else wants. We want to be able to earn a living, provide for our families, and go out dancing and celebrate. And so certainly at this moment of immense grief, we're just resolved to move forward, provide resources to those affected. Our thoughts are with the folks who are fighting for their lives in hospitals, the families of loved ones. You know, the names haven't even been released of the victims, and
yeah.
So many of us here are still waiting to make sure that our friends are all actually safe. It's a moment of fear, absolutely.
All right. Hannah Willard is Policy and Outreach Coordinator for Equality Florida. Hannah, thank you very much for coming on the program this morning. We appreciate it.
Thank you for the support.
And Linda, I guess we are still awaiting the President of the United States. We're expecting any moment now to come out and address the nation after what was the worst mass shooting in the history of our country.
And we now expect the person to come out in the next couple of minutes and to say all the words once again that he said so many times during the course of his presidency when there has been a shooting and people have died. But this is the biggest in the history of the United States, and therefore I think an extraordinarily sort of dire and awful situation.
And we have just gotten a two-minute warning, so we're expecting the president any moment now to come out. And he has done this before. He has actually referred to the fact that he has had to address the nation after mass shootings. And here is another event that he will have to be addressing. Again, the president, we're expecting him any moment now to come out and speak about a deadly shooting last night. 50 people killed at a nightclub in Orlando, Florida, downtown Orlando. As people were dancing and just finishing up around 2 o'clock in the morning, about 3 hours, a hostage situation took place during the course of those hours. The authorities went in, found far more bodies than they ever expected to find, were able to kill the shooter, who's been identified as Omar Mateen, a 29-year-old from Central Florida. We just heard a short while ago from our justice correspondent, Kerry Johnson, that Omar Mateen, this young man, called 911 to pledge allegiance to the Islamic State before he carried out this massacre inside this nightclub. And we are awaiting the President of the United States, who is going to address this any moment now, Linda.
It's an extraordinary thing to think about. The gunman in that nightclub with a huge assault rifle, apparently killing people, an extraordinary number of people that he killed. But then, what we're dealing with now is the aftermath. All of the people in the hospital, all of the families that are trying to find the people in the hospital and be sure that their people are being taken care of. We're listening to the president.
Here comes the president, it sounds like, yeah.
It sounds like you're going to hear the president.
As Americans,
here he is.
We grieve the brutal murder, a horrific massacre of dozens of innocent people. We pray for the families who are grasping for answers with broken hearts. We stand with the people of Orlando who have endured a terrible attack on their city. Although it's still early in the investigation, we know enough to say that this was an act of terror and an act of hate. And as Americans, we are united in grief, in outrage, and in resolve to defend our people. I just finished a meeting with FBI Director Comey and my Homeland Security and National Security Advisors. The FBI is on the scene and leading the investigation in partnership with local law enforcement. I directed that the full resources of the federal government be made available for this investigation. We are still learning all the facts. This is an open investigation. We've reached no definitive judgment on the precise motivations of the killer. The FBI is appropriately investigating this as an act of terrorism, and I've directed that we must spare no effort to determine what, if any, inspiration or association this killer may have had with terrorist groups. What is clear is that he was a person filled with hatred. Over the coming days, we will uncover why and how this happened, and we will go wherever the facts lead us. This morning I spoke with my good friend, Orlando Mayor Buddy Dyer, and I conveyed to him the deepest condolences of the American people. This could have been any one of our communities. So I told Mayor Dyer that whatever help he and the people of Orlando need, they are going to get it. As a country, we will be there for the people of Orlando today, tomorrow, and for all the days to come. We also express our profound gratitude to all the police and first responders who rushed to harm's way. Their courage and professionalism saved lives and kept the carnage from being even worse. It's the kind of sacrifice that our law enforcement professionals make every single day for all of us, and we can never thank them enough. This is an especially heartbreaking day for all of our friends, our fellow Americans who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender. The shooter targeted a nightclub where people came together to be with friends, to dance and to sing and to live. The place where they were attacked is more than a nightclub. It is a place of solidarity, an empowerment where people have come together to raise awareness, to speak their minds, and to advocate for their civil rights. So this is a sobering reminder that attacks on any American, regardless of race, ethnicity, religion, or sexual orientation, is an attack on all of us and on the fundamental values of equality and dignity that define us as a country. And no act of hate or terror will ever change who we are or the values that make us Americans. Today marks the most deadly shooting in American history. The shooter was apparently armed with a handgun and a powerful assault rifle. This massacre is therefore a further reminder of how easy it is for someone to get their hands on a weapon that lets them shoot people in a school, or in a house of worship, or a movie theater, or in a nightclub. And we have to decide if that's the kind of country we want to be. And to actively do nothing is a decision as well. In the coming hours and days, we'll learn about the victims of this tragedy. Their names, their faces, who they were, the joy that they brought to families and to friends, and the difference that they made in this world. Say a prayer for them. And say a prayer for their families. May God give them the strength to bear the unbearable. And that he could give us all the strength to be there for them, and the strength and courage to change. We need to demonstrate that we are defined more as a country by the way they live their lives than by the hate of the man who took them from us. As we go together, we will draw inspiration from heroic and selfless acts. Friends who helped friends, took care of each other, and saved lives. In the face of hate and violence, we will love one another. We will not give in to fear or turn against each other. Instead, we will stand united as Americans to protect our people and defend our nation and to take action against those who threaten us. May God bless the Americans we lost this morning. May he comfort their families. May God continue to watch over this country that we love. Thank you.
The President of the United States there, President Obama, talking on what he described, and as we have been describing all morning, as the worst mass shooting in the history of the United States. It took place at a nightclub in Orlando, Florida, in the early hours of this morning. NPR White House correspondent Scott Horsley on the line with us. And Scott, what struck you there from the President?
Well, a number of things, David. First of all, the President minced no words in labeling this both an act of terror and an act of hate. He said, while we don't have a definitive judgment on exactly what motivated Omar Mateen, we do know that he was a man who was filled with hatred. And you know, the President has been criticized in the past sometimes for being particularly careful in using words like terrorism or an act of terror, and he's mincing no words here. He also made a point to say that this is an especially heartbreaking day because this attack was carried out on what he called our fellow Americans who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgendered. He pointed out that this was a gay nightclub that was targeted, but that it was more than a nightclub. It was a place of solidarity and empowerment. And he said that's a sobering reminder that attacks on any Americans are attacked on all of us and our fundamental values. And then he pivoted to the point that he's made so often about just how easy it is for, in this case, one man with two guns, an assault rifle, to kill dozens of people and wound dozens of others. And he said, we have to decide if that's the kind of country we want to be. And he added, to decide to do nothing is a choice as well. That is a pretty pointed message to those who have beaten back efforts at making it harder for individuals to get this kind of assault rifle in the past.
And of course, we see after incidents like this, and I anticipate that we'll see it again, people like President Obama and people who share his views about guns talking about what they see as a moment to sort of push for some sort of some sort of gun control. I mean, the president has called it common sense gun control, but there are others in this country who believe that, you know, in a moment like this, it's a reminder that the right to have a gun is an important thing. And people believe that when they are...
They're like that. There'll be people saying if more patrons in the Pulse had been armed, that maybe they wouldn't have been so deadly. So
right,
yeah, that's an argument that we are surely going to have again. And as the president said, he didn't belabor the point, but he said we have to decide if what kind of country we want to be.
And I guess that mostly when the president says an act of terror and a person filled with hatred, it's worth remembering just exactly what we do know at this point. Omar Mateen, 29 years old, from Fort Pierce, Florida, a couple hours from Orlando, along the southeast coast, the Atlantic coast of Florida. The authorities there, we do know, have been searching his apartment this morning. We know he is a U.S. citizen. We know that before he carried out this attack, he made a call to 911 to collect his with the gay, lesbian, transgender community.
Congressman Adam Schiff highlighted that distinction in a statement earlier today. He's, of course, the ranking Democrat on the Intelligence Committee, and mm-hmm. he's been getting regular updates on this. The fact that that Omar Mateen made that call to 911 at pledging allegiance to Islamic State suggests that this was, at a minimum, ISIS-inspired. Whether it was ISIS-directed is another question, and that's something that maybe we'll learn more about as the investigation proceeds. But folks are certainly thinking it is no accident that the target of this bloodshed was a gay nightclub, and that hatred was part of the motivation. Adam Schiff's also a congressman from California, and he noted in his statement that he was going to be marching in West Hollywood's gay pride parade today. Marching, he said, with a heavy heart, but also in solidarity with all those victims and their families.
You're listening to special coverage from NPR News, and joining us on the line now is Brian Levin, who is the director of the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism at Cal State San Bernardino. Mr. Levin, obviously there are still a great many questions, but one of the things we have just heard from the president is that the president is rejecting the distinction that David and I have been carefully making all morning between hate crime and terrorism. He basically says this is it's all of it.
And he's right, although as a matter of fact, it depends on what stage we're talking about. So what happens in these kind of investigations, the FBI, if something appears to be linked in some way, even indirectly, to foreign radicalism such as Daesh, ISIS, AQAP, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. Apparently, as we've heard, there's been a phone call by the assailant to 911 pledging his allegiance to al-Baghdadi, the head of ISIS, tells us that it is both. Terrorism is defined as using force or threat to influence social or political change against a population or subgroup. Clearly, terrorism is a symbolic target, the LGBT American community, but it's also a hate crime. A hate crime is a crime where someone selects a target because of the actual or perceived group status of another. Operationally, though, a terrorism designation throws this into the FBI's ambit where they will then take charge of the investigation, and they will coordinate the investigation with local authorities and regional authorities through the Joint Terrorism Task Force. So there's an operational reason that they mentioned terrorism, but it is also certainly functionally a hate crime as well, but that's not going to change how the investigation goes. A terrorism designation has operational significance that other kinds of designations do not, particularly this early.
Now, one of the things we were hearing earlier this morning from officials in Florida was they were using the phrase lone wolf, that they consider that that might have been a possibility that this person was, I hesitate to use the word inspired, but he was drawn to what he knew about ISIS, and that he committed an act which certainly ISIS is finding a lot of sympathy for him for this act. They've been praising it. What do you know about these stealth lone wolves? Is this something that we in America have to be very, very concerned about? Something similar to what happened in San Bernardino?
Yes, and interestingly enough, I testified before Congress several weeks before the tragic attack that hit our community and warned specifically about these internet-inspired but not orchestrated and directed assailants. And that's the one of the main strategies that ISIS has been trying to do to hit the American homeland, because they do not have the pipeline of people who have come in and out of theater and then going back to countries in Europe like Belgium, Kosovo, and elsewhere. So I also testified about this back in 1995. So we've seen leaderless resistance, lone wolf attacks be encouraged across the spectrum of extremist ideologies, and it's just today that Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula and Daesh or ISIS is encouraging it. Indeed, they say, go hit soft targets where you live. If you can't come and join us, hit folks where you live. Don't worry about it. Hit folks in your community where you live. And then they define who are appropriate targets for aggression. And one thing that ISIS has done has killed dozens upon dozens of people by binding their hands, throwing them upside down, off loose, onto their heads, and if they live, stoning them to death. And this is by judicial decree under ISIS, and in many parts of the Middle East, being gay or undertaking gay relations mm-hmm. is punishable, because it's something that's referenced in both the Quran, with not so much a punishment, but then in the Hadith.
Now let me ask you this. This is the single worst attack, the single worst shooting in the United States. What does that mean for the country, do you think, that this is such an escalation?
And this is exactly what I spoke about before the Homeland Security Committee. And to their credit, they have been absolutely stellar. The problem is, these are stealth individuals. They're oftentimes criminals, disenfranchised folks, or mentally unstable. ISIS is happy to take them all, and then what happens is they pledge bayat or allegiance to al-Baghdadi, the leader of ISIS. This is welcome to a trend that we've been in the middle of for some time. And what it also is, by the way, it's the worst hate attack in recent American history. Usually in any given year, we have between, let's say, according to the FBI, 5 to maybe 17 hate-related homicides counted by the FBI. It could even be higher because of reporting issues. But in one attack, we now have more deaths in a hate-motivated attack than we've seen the culmination of many years combined. And that shows you how significant it is. And our hearts go out to our friends in Orlando, and especially to the LGBT community. They've been identified as a legitimate target of aggression by ISIS, and ISIS sends out videos showing this kind of brutality.
Brian Levin is director of the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism at Cal State San Bernardino. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me on this terrible morning.
And Linda, it is a terrible morning. This is the worst mass shooting in the history of the United States that took place in Orlando last night. I as we sort through, I guess we think about things like the Oklahoma City bombing, where there were upwards of 170 people killed. I mean, there have been tragedies on this scale and beyond, but the largest mass shooting in this country's history. And we're awaiting another news conference from the authorities in Orlando and the mayor. We'll try to bring that to you when it happens. Let's bring another voice in here. Mike Miller is a member of the Florida House of Representatives. He is a Republican, represents part of Orlando, and his office, as I understand it, Representative, not far at all from Pulse, the nightclub where this happened last night.
Yeah, David, thank you, first of all, for having me on. It's a really tough day for me here. This is actually right in the heart of my district, and my district office is across the street from the Pulse, and I drive by there for the last 20 years, thousands and thousands of times. There's never been anything like this in our community.
You drive by it and think of it as very much part of the fabric of your community, as I imagine, a place where people go and have fun and have a few drinks and dance the night away.
Absolutely. I mean, the LGBT community here in Central Florida, we've not ever experienced, at least since I've been in the House of Representatives, we've never experienced anything like this. So I wouldn't pay it any mind at all. I would drive by just as any other place that we have here in Central Florida. We encourage people to come to Central Florida. We don't discriminate based on anything. We want people to come. That's why we have almost 100 million Floridians, or excuse me, 100 million Americans come to Florida every year. 65 million of them come right here to Orlando.